Thanks very much, Nate. It's a real privilege to be here and to represent CSIS and to have worked with you in putting this panel together. I think this is, I never miss an opportunity to have a conversation with you, but this one's in public, so we'll keep the profanity to a minimum. In starting on roles and missions and thinking about what I wanted to say here, I did what I usually do, which is ask people who are a lot smarter than me. And I went around my office and asked Maren Lead and Kath Hicks and Clark Murdoch, a number of folks I work with, and I said, what do you think about roles and missions? They said, I have very strong views on that. I'll tell you what I think. But then when it came down to it, there really actually weren't a lot of strong recommendations from people who always have strong recommendations, which told me something important at the beginning of this panel, which is that maybe roles and missions are not quite the huge issue they have been historically for the U.S. military. I would say roles and missions are a huge deal for U.S. government writ large. They're a major issue for the Department of Homeland Security. I mean, oh my gosh, talk about redundancy in every facet of every component at DHS. But when we actually turn to DOD, what is important about roles and missions? And I think the concept to frame a useful discussion on how we can achieve military effects that we need to over the next decade like we have over the past, that's an important one. So I'm going to refine a little bit what I think are the key roles and missions questions. And because I'm, again, not smart enough to answer those, I will turn those over to the rest of the panel. So starting with that, I will say that during the QDR, I kept hearing rumors about this very high-level, very hush-hush chairman's group doing roles and missions. I didn't see it at all in the QDR, and I don't know if anybody else heard what came from that, but no sooner did I hear about that than I heard about a high-level review going on in roles and missions at PACOM. And I think why we hear all of this talk about roles and missions and we don't see the output is what we're actually grappling with now is a really large gap between force strategy or actual defense strategy and force capacity, a lack of prioritization and a desire to hold on to a defense strategy that itself may no longer be tenable. So we're looking for magic solutions to our inability to prioritize and to drop missions where we need to. Yesterday, General Mayville, the Joint Staff J3, said, we're not going to do more with less, we're going to do less with less. In the QDR assessment, the Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff wrote, with our ends fixed and our means declining, it's imperative we innovate within the ways we defend the nation. In addition to the QDR, the Strategic Choices and Management Review over the summer that preceded the QDR, Vice Chairman Winnefeld went out of his way and he said, we didn't come up with any dramatic changes in service organization or anything like that, but there was considerable effort involved in the ways. So maybe we're using the way ways, we're using ways instead of roles and missions, but to me it seems like the debates are somewhat merged. And I would also say that it is true that DOD hasn't taken a hard look at roles or missions in and of themselves recently, and there are probably two reasons for that. The first one is what I already said. Maybe there's not much there. The efficiencies to be gained have been gained. The second is maybe there's just not initiative to do that, that there's too much else that the department is grappling with in terms of just fiscal constraints and so forth to look at it. But there's a third possibility, which is that there just isn't high-level civilian interest that's been historically required to look at roles and missions. Key West happened under the direct involvement of Secretary Forrestal and of President Truman, and of course, Secretary Forrestal had a nervous breakdown, maybe because of that effort. DOD last officially looked at roles and missions in the services, Joint Staff and OSD, and codified it in 2010, DOD Directive 5100-01. In 2008, Congress had enacted a requirement for a quadrennial roles and missions review. DOD conducted one in 2009 and again in 2012, and Congress was so dissatisfied with the 2012 report, which they said only looked at missions and really repeated the defense strategic guidance, that they asked GAO to conduct an inquiry on roles and missions that's still going on. So in terms of the questions for this panel, I think the first one is, it correct to still say that missions belong to the COCOMs and roles to the services? Which missions in that formulation are falling through the crack? What can we learn from a SOCOM model where you have roles and missions in one? How should we balance efficiency with effectiveness? That's ultimately the trade-off in roles and missions. And in which missions is effectiveness, i.e. redundancy, to a certain degree, more important than efficiency? Is the supply-demand dynamic about right between the COCOMs and the services? Is the joint staff playing the right role or a useful role in moderating supply-demand dynamics? We always hear how COCOM demand is insatiable. Well, is that a problem? Are the COCOMs wrong, or are we just not meeting the requirements of the COCOMs, and therefore we have to think about dropping missions? What role should OSD play in all of this? What are key roles and missions to examine that are new? Traditionally, roles and missions examinations come about due to new technology, either ours or adversary technology. What about cyber, unmanned systems, ISR, precision strike? And I would just point out on cyber and unmanned systems, there was a conscious decision made by Secretary Gates not to appoint an executive agent. How has that worked or not worked? And have we sufficiently accounted for interagency nature of roles and missions and DOD's role and what we're doing in phase zero in homeland security and defense? I know the other panelists are planning to cover that. So finally, just a few observations also for consideration here. I would say we do see roles and missions blurring, but it's maybe not where you would expect it. It's not actually between the services at this point, and the tensions are not between the services. Sometimes it's in fact within the services. If there's a problem in jointness today, I would argue, for instance, that the Navy's surface warfare units, amphibious units in the U.S. Marine Corps are perhaps more joint than Navy surface warfare and submarine communities on facing some of the key challenges in the Asia Pacific. Same could be true for within the United States Air Force. ISR and unmanned systems operators are in some ways closer to ground forces and to the special operations force community than they are to the rest of the Air Force. So looking at roles and missions internal to the services. And finally, should we use roles and missions to create greater competency? Is there concern about the U.S. Air Force and the roles that it conducts in support of the nuclear mission? Are there other areas where services might be underperforming or at risk where we might want to think about a transfer to a service that maybe has a lighter mission load? And fourth, another example, going back to phase zero, does every service need foreign area officers? Is there competence and jointness across the foreign area officer community? So I'll close with all those tough questions and no answers.
Great.
I think we're okay to go in the order we're in right now. So Jerry, if you want to go next, that's great.
All right. Let me start by making two points. As I think the only active duty person up here on the panel, I'll just start out by saying that the views expressed are my own and definitely not the United States Navy's views. Secondly, let me start also say that I think Richard Haass is a remarkably intelligent individual, and especially in his recognition of the relative importance of air and naval power at this time. We soon will be awash in strategy documents. QDR is out. New maritime strategy is coming out this summer. Navy Marine Corps joint strategy is being discussed. Army strategy, air power strategy, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But to do what? To whom? For what purpose? The last great strategy was Kennan's containment strategy, of course, and he stated that the Soviet Union contained the seeds of its own downfall, lodged deeply in Russian prehistory, history, and its culture, and he was right. Today, we spent a lot of time talking about competitors, but is that the right standard of measurement? Europe is fractured in its culture, language, and history, and does not seem to be coming together at any time soon. Russia, despite its recent forays into Georgia and the Crimea, is facing declining fortunes in its petroeconomy, facing declining energy prices due to the advent of fracking, and Europe has awakened to its bellicosity. In addition, its birth rate is decreasing and its alcoholism is increasing, while its military is still characterized largely by Soviet-era equipment and failing new technologies that are not getting buyers elsewhere. China is more interesting. Its economy continues to grow rapidly, although not in double digits. It has shown signs of decreasing production. Its infrastructure-based home economy is maxed out. and there are whole cities that sit vacant in the interior, remnants of overbuilding. Its military is under expansion, and there's been certain innovations that will prove challenging, but China's military remains relatively small compared to the entire U.S. military, but is able to form a concentration of power in its near seas, and this is problematic for the United States. China's chief challenge will be its desire to become great before it gets old. This is an outgrowth of its one-child policy, which will soon see one child supporting two parents and four grandparents. There will come a time when all that savings that's being stored up now will soon have to come flowing out of the Chinese treasury to pay for social welfare costs of the one-child policy. China's only hope and desire is to go ahead and assume a leading role as an economic power in the world and perhaps even be able to revalue international domination in its own currency. China is not our enemy and will not become our enemy unless we enable it to do so. So the U.S. military's main challenge is itself. It's not competing against anyone seriously, but it's a major strategic challenge is its own internal debt, its internal political processes, and its position in the world. While its economy is growing smaller and purchasing power parity in comparison to the fast-rising China, it's still rather large and robust. Its military is larger than the next 10 militaries combined, and six of those are our allies. We have strategic altitude, but we are experiencing serious drag on our forward motion from our significant debt. We will need to either cut discretionary spending, cut entitlements, or raise revenues. Most likely solution should be a combination of all three. Regardless of the final equation, defense spending will be cut again. I believe that our current defense budget of nearly $500 billion will shrink to $400 billion or lower, and we must plan accordingly. Most will complain that such cuts will restrict our strategic flexibility and hollow out our force, but these events will occur only if we choose to continue our current strategic path and current force structures. For instance, if the Navy were to attempt to preserve its current supercarrier-centric force structure, a budget cut of 20% will cause the Navy to shrink by two aircraft carriers from 11 to 9. And the fleet will shrink from 280 ships to approximately 240 ships or lower. If, however, we take another path, we could actually grow the fleet from 280 to 330 ships within 8 years. Before I get into this, I think it's important to share an insight that I received from a former national security advisor who told me that the military services needed to change their focus from preparing for the wars that they want to fight, in other words, the wars that help to justify their large programs and current expenditures, to prepare for wars that they are likely to fight. That he was a retired Air Force Lieutenant General added to my appreciation of his insight. So with that in mind, I believe that the U.S. military and the Navy in particular, which is my area of expertise, needs to do, which is to position itself to sustain the current global system of governance, which is characterized by free trade, free navigation of seas, support for self-determination, individual rights, and a stable global economy. To do this, we need to remain forward-deployed and forward-based. We need to be in those vital economic zones such as the Western Pacific, the Arabian Gulf, and increasingly those waters around Africa. Given the current political climate, we need forces that require none too light footprints and an ability to sustain themselves at a distance. This suggests the importance of naval and other expeditionary forces. The fact is, as already stated, that we will not be able to do this under the compressed budget with our current force structure, which means that we need to evolve a new force structure. We need to grow our force and can do so by investing just 10% of our shipbuilding budget, approximately $1.2 billion, into smaller, cheaper, and more numerous craft to expand our presence. These platforms, littoral combat ships, joint high-speed vessels, afloat forward staging bases, and riverine boats, forward-based and forward-deployed, would serve to influence key regions and maintain the rule sets to include an adherence to that body of international law that we have labored 60 years to build. Building partnership capacity and providing security force assistance at sea should be a focus. To be sure, we will need to begin moving away from our current naval force structure. The Navy currently builds a new supercarrier every 5 years. This has been an extravagance that we can no longer afford. Their utility has declined, their costs have gone up, and their vulnerability has gone up as well. But we should understand that if we were to stop these investments now and begin drawing these platforms down in a natural progression, we will retain carrier capability for decades to come. Once the USS Ford comes into full service, we can expect it to remain in service for the next 50 years. We also need to make a concerted effort to invest in research and development. We should give some thought to the newly emergent technologies, what I would might call Manhattan projects, that will allow us to emerge from our period of retrenchment with new leap-ahead technologies that will position us for continued strategic leadership. I'm not prepared to identify these technologies at this time, but would suggest that they are not and should not be readily evident. They, in fact, should be hidden, but that they portend significant strategic leap-ahead potential. In the meantime, and by that I mean between now and 2025, we need to focus on lowering our deficit spending. If we do not do so, by 2025, at current rate of expenditure, 100% of our budget will be dedicated to meeting our entitlement commitments and paying the interest on our debt. There will be no discretionary spending, which is to say that there will be no defense budget. We in the Department of Defense need to get ahead of this situation and figure out how to manage the next 10 years. As I said earlier, we are currently have strategic altitude due to the size of our force. And we need to trade strategic altitude for strategic airspeed, streamlining our forces, focusing on conflicts that we're likely to fight, investing in forward-deployed, forward-based presence, and making significant investments in research and development. Each service should be prepared to reinvent itself, gradually to be sure, but significantly in the end. Thank you.
Great. Well, Nate, thank you very much. I'm honored to be here with the rest of the panelists. I resisted the temptation to put up a slide, having been scarred by some 40 or 50,000 of them in my last 3 years, but what I'm going to say to you is significantly shaped by 3 years as the Air Force A8 working force structure issues, and 2 years before that as Director of Plans, Policy, and Strategy for U.S. NORTHCOM, working homeland defense issues. So since you're not going to get a slide, at some point I'm going to ask you to help imagine with me a couple of scenarios, and hopefully that'll illuminate my point. Nothing I'm going to say here is intended to contradict what we heard yesterday or earlier this morning, and I recognize that issues of mission command, joint forcible entry, how we do our business remain important, and getting them right as part of our approach to joint warfare is necessary. I am going to be a little bit orthogonal, perhaps, to the issue of roles and missions as we classically think about them. I'm going to talk about offense-defense balance in how we think about the future. And what that means for roles and missions between the services, which I would argue is not much, what that future may mean in terms of roles and missions between active and reserve components, which I think is potentially a lot, and between parts of our national security enterprise, which could be a lot, could be a little, but is very important to discuss. If you look at what the recent QDR said, it outlined a defense strategy that rests on three pillars. First one was to protect the homeland, to defer it, deter and defeat attacks on the United States, and to support civil authorities in mitigating the effects of potential attacks and natural disasters. Second pillar was to build security globally in order to preserve regional stability, deter adversaries, support allies and partners, and cooperate with others to address common security challenges. And the third pillar was to project power and win decisively, to defeat aggression, disrupt and destroy terrorist networks, and provide humanitarian assistance and disaster relief. Pretty big job jars, all three of them, and has been the case in several cycles of defense strategy statements. Protecting the homeland is listed as the first priority, but I would argue that this is something that deserves renewed consideration. It's been frequently stated as an end, but the ways and means have probably not been developed to the extent they need to. Accomplishing all three of these objectives, I would say as background, implies a bedrock demand for U.S. forces to continue to provide day-to-day nuclear deterrence. Achieving them demands we modernize the joint force to remain credible in terms of the forces, posture, and capabilities we project in the conventional arena against increasingly sophisticated A2AD threats. And we have to be able to dissuade others from interdicting the global commons of airspace, cyber, and sea. Retaining the ability to do these things is absolutely essential to stability in crisis and day-to-day. I would also argue that in the background, there are two kinds of disruptive threats, one of which my colleague to the right just mentioned. And those are interventions and budget pressures that draw away from our ability to take care of our fundamental responsibility, which is defending the people and territory of the United States. The second disruptive threat is one that could be externally imposed, and one that we haven't had to deal with much over certainly the history that all of us in this room have lived, and that is the possibility that by those who have been watching us and going to school on what we do for decades, sustaining a tactical or operational level defeat of some magnitude that would change the way we look at ourselves and our allies and the way the rest of the world looks at us. As a result of Goldwater-Nichols in the mid-80s and the decades of conflict since then, I would argue that we get it when it comes to joint warfare. We fight jointly. We have structured and trained the force to fight jointly. The last decade plus of conflict has meant that well over half of our active force has grown up with strong organizational and individual ties that bind them together and enable them to fight using the assets that their services bring to the table, using the training in a way that's synergistic. So I don't think we have a great deal of realignment to do to use what we have in the ways we have been using it. But that doesn't mean we can happily keep on doing exactly what we've done. And I do think, as adjunct to this roles and missions discussion, we need to be thoughtful about adapting the weight of effort within our services and across our service boundaries. One example of change within service boundaries, I think there's a case to be made the Army will be driven over time to substantially increase its air defense artillery efforts and effectiveness over time. Our adversaries are acquiring the same kinds of precision weapons that we've had for years. They are acquiring missiles that can attack our deployed forces. We have fewer Air Force platforms that can conduct the offensive counter-air and interdict at the point of departure as we have in the past. And so if we are going to have the same kinds of low attrition we have had for years, we're going to have to think more about defense in the deployed warfighting environment. We're also going to have to think about weight of effort, and that's just one example. We could all come up with more. Weight of effort between services will undoubtedly be forced on us by shrinking resources as well. We've all heard the four Air Forces debate. I think that's passé. All of the services need air assets to do the things they do. But medium altitude ISR, for example, is an area where we need to match our resources and our appetites better. How much needs to belong to the Air Force? How much needs to be operationally tasked and distributed? How much is organic to a brigade combat team? This isn't really a roles and missions debate. This is a debate about how much of each service's portfolio do we invest in a particular kind of thing. I spent a little while back in 2010 working on DOD 5100.0 or .1. Functions of the Department of Defense and its major components. And interestingly, roles and missions doesn't really appear in that. But through that discussion, the core functions of the services changed little. There was a lot of look at what they should be. There was not a lot of desire or perceived need to change it. The core mission elements, the core functions of each of the services pretty much came through that intact. And the common functions, the things that we all need to do, also came through that intact. One of the discussions that didn't get to the maturity that I think it needed then and really needs now is there are functions that we all do that we need to do, but we do them because we're interdependent. So, for example, combat search and rescue. No single service is going to have the assets or the global distribution of those assets to do combat search and rescue every place that it might need to be done. So we all need it. How much can we afford? What should it look like? And who should specialize in which parts of it? And that is an unfinished discussion. But let me, as I'm gobbling up time here, let me return to my main concern, which is the offense and defense balance. Yeah, got it. Okay, I'm going to use a football analogy despite the fact that I was a fencer in college. Playing field of the past, nice square gridiron. The teams line up on either side. We had active folks in the front line, reserve in the back line, coalition partners interwoven throughout, depending on the field. Bench was deep, contained active, reserve, coalition players. Everybody generally played by the rules, and the goal was to move the ball to the goal line. Not all players had the same quality or color of uniform, but you could kind of tell who was who and what they were going to do. And we had recruiters and scouts scattered all over the country, all over the environment, helping us understand what was coming. We've made economic choices, and the world's evolved in ways that make that game kind of history. And as General Mayville said yesterday, we're not going to be in as many places as we were before. So the scouts and recruits are less numerous. The new game is nonlinear. It's more like the Linus clump and a big dust cloud. There may be more than one ball, and it may not be a football. The goal line is sometimes at the center of the clump, and sometimes it's on one end of the field. Some of the players wear uniforms, and some don't. Some are carrying sidearms, and they'll use them against players, spectators, or the ball. Bottom line is, we have had a prevent defense. We have been out there being offensive, in other words, present, proactive, for all of our professional lives. We are in an era where we are not going to be able to do that the way we have in the past, and therefore the importance of defense is increasing, and the definition of defense, as in defending the territory and people of this nation against consequential attacks in cyber or any other domain, is becoming much more important. And so that's where, to cut to the chase, I think we need to look hard at how we balance our active force versus our guard and reserve force, and not so much change the size of the components, but change their ability to deal with that defensive mission. So for example, from my past, I'll give you an example that resonates with me. The 509th Bomb Wing used to be our only active duty B-2 unit. Some years ago, a decision was made to move a guard unit from Lambert Field in St. Louis to Whiteman to pick up the B-2 mission. So we have the Missouri Guard operating the B-2, and they're doing a great job, by the way. Their maintainers, their operators, all superb. However, there is no case in which I can ever see the governor of Missouri needing a B-2. The governor of Missouri may, however, need the communications, the support folks associated with that wing. And so with our Guard and Reserve partners, over time, I would argue that we need to take a serious look at the alignment between particularly the guard missions that are assigned, the guard equipment that is assigned, and the missions that governors may need them to do in support of creating resiliency in our nation. If we do that, then we will essentially make our active forces more capable of playing the away game, our reserve forces more capable of playing the home game, and the joint force, active and reserve, more capable of dealing with the range of missions, which I think includes a greater component of defense than it has in our history, the history of those of us alive here. I'd be happy to take more questions about that. The last thing I'll say is that bit of thinking about the defense side of things, when you're talking about cyber in particular, points to a seam that still exists and has closed somewhat since the formation of DHS after 9/11, but it is far from closed. And if I were going to make one call, I would say it's probably time to dust off some of the previous national commissions and think about a new National Security Act that truly looks at national security from infrastructure through forward deployed operations and brings those seams between the Department of Defense and the Department of Homeland Security, including all of the players who contribute to both, into tighter focus for the future. Thank you very much.
Thank you. There we go. Thank you very much for the invitation to be here. Thanks for being such a great host. This is the one conference every year that I mark down that's a must-go to come to. Not only because of the great design of the conferences, but a pretty hard audience. I've lived in Washington for the last 30 years, serving in a couple administrations, and the average audience in Washington is just a bunch of press guys that came for the free donuts, and I don't think there are any free donuts out there. So you're obviously here because of the, yeah, that's it. The reason I got invited here, because I think because I published a paper last year out of the Foreign Policy Research Institute, in which I imagined a future chairman being so frustrated with 3, 4, and 5 years of sequestration, 3 years of continuing resolutions and a diminishing budget, that the chairman replaced Mr. Forrestal and flew to Key West II, not like 1947 with just three services, but in fact took all seven and eight services down and took the National Guard Bureau, took SOCOM, took the NSA, took the Marine Corps this time, and went down there and tried to resolve that. It was a very provocative paper, and I threw out a whole bunch of really crazy ideas about merging the Guard and Reserve and doing away with Marine fixed-wing aviation. And so I guess I'm here to be the provocative provocateur. So this will be my last chance to try to do that for a few years, so I'm going to try to do it. I disagree with a few of my partners here, but I do agree with General Miller that the notion of boundaries and portfolio balance, I think, is the real issue. It's not the classical sense. My picture here is representative of a theme. I hope I don't offend anybody with biblical references, but we've been living in the Old Testament world, and it's time to move to a New Testament. And if you're a Russell Crowe fan and been watching any movies lately, I think an arc makes a very interesting theme. There is a huge gap between what we want to be and the resources we are being given and the will of the nation to do the things that we have traditionally done in the Old Testament. And I view the roles and missions, boundaries, and the lens as a lens to try to get at some of these issues to close what is a chasm between what we want to do and the resources the country is being given us. So the arc that I think some people want to get on is the ramp for which we need to start thinking about things. I wasn't aware that Ms. Fox was going to come up and brief you. She's a great lady, has done a wonderful job in the building, so I'm not going to have to spend a lot of time on the QDR. But the QDR, as it was briefed to you this week, is what I call a framing document. It laid out the gap between what we want to do and some of the resources required to do it, and it made an argument for why we need more resources. Those resources, I agree with Captain Hendrix, are not forthcoming. So the lower end of what you see in the QDR is the best case of what we need to plan for. And the administration, Mr. Hagel's comment here notwithstanding, didn't really face up to the reality. The last sentence is the most important sentence. There are difficult decisions ahead. The QDR raised those questions, but it did not make decisions of them. And to steal a line from Richard Hobbs today, it's going to get worse, and then it can get worse. And I think goals and missions is a lens that we might be able to look at to get at that. Richard Hobbs, again, I wasn't aware of the content of his remarks when I prepared mine today, but the coming storm and the flood that's going to, I think, hit the national security arena, I think was very well covered by Richard. The problem is more challenges, a broadening of missions, some new, some old, some less important, some more important, requires to make adaptations. And the fixed resource shares or the traditional missions and roles that we've assigned to the services that have accreted over 50, 60, and 70 years of habit need to be adjusted. The joint worlds worked at that, OSD continues to work at that, but we still have some work to do. It's compounded by fewer resources, much higher personnel costs, much higher infrastructure costs, way too much tail for what we have, and it's going to cut into the teeth, and it's going to require us to make some adaptations. We do have some unresolved modernization and resetting costs we need to deal with, and we have to stop buying equipment that has 4, 5, 6, and 7-to-1 replacement factors. You cannot replace $20 million helicopters with an $80 million helicopter, and you cannot replace a $50,000 Jeep with a $3.7 million vehicle. And we have a lot of those kinds of things going on. I totally agree with Dr. Haas's comments about coalitions, very important. I actually think folks are going to want to join more coalitions. Unfortunately, the people that want to join aren't going to bring much to the table. Most of our allies, particularly in Europe, but also in Japan, are older societies, poorer societies, with huge demographic, infrastructural, and structural deficiencies. They're not going to be bringing as much to the table as they did in the past. But we'll still need to bind together with coalitions of the willing, even when they're less capable. But that's going to put more pressure on our defense as well. And I think Mr. Haas was probably underestimating the ebbing of political support that was raised. Brian's excellent question about popular support. That's ebbing. That's not just related to a decade of war and a $2 trillion investment that people don't think we got a nice return on investment. That's a demographic reality. That's an economic structural reality about the lower half of the socioeconomic income of this country. And it's where some of the political elites are. And those forces are getting stronger, not weaker. So there is a coming storm. And again, I liked this line from Russell Crowe, that storm is coming, it's real, it can't be stopped, but it definitely can be survived. And I think roles and missions is really the lens we need to look at to try to get to that portfolio balance. I won't belabor the old covenant, but that's 50, 60, 70 years old, and we're under the same circumstances. We're coming out of a major war. There are political schisms about what the future might be. There are new technologies, and there's drastically fewer resources. And it forced a conversation that was bitter, wasn't really lived up to, but the senior leadership, both political and military, tried to resolve it. I don't think we're at the same level yet. We haven't resolved it, but we're in the same market. We're facing new technologies. People could get into different games on ISR, cyber. There's competition for resources. The resources are going down the same kind of scale. We're downsizing, and we're not dealing with some of these issues to the degree that we should. So we need a new covenant. I'd like to categorically reject Richard Haas's comment about Asia. I'm familiar, being a retired naval officer, that there's a lot of blue on a map in Asia, but I'm also a historian and working on a Ph.D. at King's College in history, and I understand that Vietnam occurred, Korea occurred, and World War II occurred, and I think the Army was heavily involved in all these theaters. So the notion that it's air and naval space might be a strategic desire, or it might be an impulse, but I don't think it's taking into factor some historical issues. We're going to have a smaller Army. It's not going to be the Army we want. We're going to have to concentrate resources on a narrower mission scale for the Army. We're going to have 30 to 32 BCTs, and they're going to have to be ass-kicking, modernized, fully ready, somewhere, you know, C1 kind of units, not dissipated doing a lot of secondary and tertiary kind of issues. So we're going to have to focus on that mission. That might be less forward stationed, that might be less engaged, but that's the deterrent and decisive land power that the country needs. The Navy, I agree with Jerry, we're going to have a fleet of about 240 ships. We're going to have one or two less carriers. The politicians will probably try to keep every carrier, and then they will unbalance the fleet in every other possible area that we're actually going to need as enablers to keep up the image of iconic symbols that are outdated, more vulnerable, and not worth the investment. The Navy is going to invest and become the strategic deterrent force. We can argue about the nuclear business, but I don't believe we can afford to try it anymore, and we're going to have to make a hard call on what it is. I prefer not to invest in ballistic missile submarines because I want to attack submarines because that's the way I want to play in Asia, but that's not the way the nation's going to go. But the Navy will become the strategic deterrent force, and I'm willing to trade them out of cyber and space as a missionary and give that the Air Force as partial compensation. The Marine Corps, probably can't go all the way like I'd like to. The Marine Corps' conception of itself since 1950 is based on an outdated mode and outdated legislation, and we need to rethink what it is that they want the Marine Corps to do. It is bigger than the armies of most of our allies in Europe in terms of their ground forces. So I'm very inclined to the kind of language that General Amos has been putting out about a crisis response force, and I'm willing to design the Marine Corps for that express purpose. And that's not a Marine Corps that needs tanks. It doesn't need a lot of other things. It doesn't need a lot of Corps headquarters. I don't see it as a complement in a second or a third land army for the United States. Again, we're going to have to get on the arc. There's probably going to be closer to two of everything, not three and four, as we move forward. That's the metaphor for the arc today. However, if you're going to be a crisis response force and you're going to be four and the president's going to have to do something in a NEO or something like that, the Joint Strike Fighter Bravo on some Muse is something I can see as a fifth generation capability in a variety of the capability sets that are on that vehicle. So I'd end up keeping, instead of 18 flying squadrons for the Marine Corps, I'd have just cut them down to 8 for that particular mission, that particular capability. And that's, so they still get the role and they get the mission, but the portfolio balance goes down quite a bit. Air Force would be the force of the future for me. A lot less of the short air, TAC air, strategic bombing, long range strike, ISR, space and cyber. Special forces, I want to keep them special. So they wouldn't have as much growth. I wouldn't be overusing them globally, networked forces. I'd keep them within a more traditional role, some size. I'd scrap the network. I would invest in some of the enablers, helicopters, ISR, and some of the other things that they're specifically short. I don't care what the cost is for that. I'd give SOCOM the top dollar for those capabilities. The Guard and Reserve, I'd have a little more diversification, I think, in the Guard between warfighting and homeland security. So I'd have a 4 or 5 divisions of warfighting force and maybe split some of the, both from a homeland and an overseas stability operations, a post-crisis capability, whether the disaster was here in the United States or over, and differentiate a little bit. If you're only going to have 32 training days or 39 training days, focus on a mission and do it very well and stop trying to cover the entire market. In that line, I would just divest Northern Command and merge Northern Command and Southern Command into one headquarters just to reduce some of the headquarters. Again, make hard decisions and move forward. Cyber warfare, we are doing every possible model. Every service wants a cyber force. We have a cyber command. We have an NSA. We defense agencies, operational commands. There's just too much investment in that area. We have no idea what we're buying with the extra people or the extra dollars. We just know it's a new technology. It is. We should explore it and very rationally try to move forward. If we need to go the way we're going, fine, but we're throwing a lot of money at a problem I don't think we understand very much. And the biggest thing is we got to get at the Fourth Estate and the Pentagon. We got 130,000 people and $84 billion a year going into what is basically defense business operations, and we need to get at that and suppress the appetite for that kind of capability. And that's where the politicians and the Congress needs to help the department with infrastructure reduction, base closures, and other areas. And the one exception for this institution and for the one that I currently work at, an exhortation, an urge, an imperative for us is not to view education, human capital development as overhead. Stop the cuts on the educational system, Leavenworth, Newport, NDU in here. Freeze that at some level, 2007, 2010, and just baseline that. Do not look at the future intellectual development of tomorrow's officer corps, all the generals that are and admirals that are sitting in this room, as a cost. This is an investment in the future, one that clearly pays off. So summary, there is a storm coming to you, whether you want it or not, and I'm not talking about NOAA. We need to really think about this as a different lens. The covenant, the Old Testament, is 70 years old, new technologies. We've made some adjustments, but I'm afraid I think that Gold Wars Nichols has sometimes become sort of a lockbox on Pandora's box, and we're afraid to get at the turf fights because they're uncomfortable. People have a sense of identity and have previous investments in a lot of different areas, and it's just really uncomfortable to get at that. But that's the only way to get at redundancy. It's the only way to identify resources to invest in the broadening mission set that I think DoD is being given. So roles and missions is just a lens. It's not a panacea. We actually have a very resilient force today that I think is very adaptive. It's very desirable to retain that to some degree. But on the current path, all we're going to have is a smaller force that is less modernized. And we're going to uncover some missions that I think we really need to get at. So for me, it's not important to have a balanced force. It's to have a more focused force that with a narrow set of roles and missions in investment area. And remember, at the end of the day, only two of everything can get on the arc. Thank you very much.
So I think Frank's storm's already here. And I think the water's getting pretty deep. And I really also don't think this is much about roles and missions in the traditional way we've been looking at this. So I happen to spend about 26 months as the J5, and I watch senior leaders in the building try to deal with ends, ways, and means constantly. I think you got a good primer from DepSec Def Fox, Acting DepSec Def Fox, when she was here earlier this week, where she kind of laid out the vision of where the department is going based on the submission of the 15 to 19 budget. And if you didn't take copious notes, if that didn't cause you to go back and take a good look at the QDR, you probably should. And you ought to look with great intent at the chairman's assessment, risk assessment in the back, the last couple of pages. It's off of his pen, I can tell from his writing style, and it's worth taking a good hard look at. So I just want to give you one quick passage, kind of I've paraphrased a little bit from about the QDR. And Sam talked a little bit about this. So with the ends, pair in my mind, national objectives somewhat fixed, and our means, the resources declining, it's imperative that we innovate within the ways, and that's what Frank and others are kind of talking about, those operational concepts as we accomplish the tasks given to us by the nation. And the nation's going to give you more tasks than you have resources to be able to accomplish. There's no doubt about that. I watched that from seven of the last 10 years in Washington and in many, many meetings in the interagency. I also think that rebalance is a pretty critical comment. And I think it's a pretty critical theme that flows throughout the QDR. And remember, the Defense Strategic Guidance, in my mind, is the precursor the QDR follows. They are linked together, and they form a continuum, in my mind, of the revision of U.S. strategy. So that rebalance of the Joint Force, as Joint Force 2020 continues to be developed, it's about modernizing it. It's about being capable, ready. It's about using innovation, adaption, all these buzzwords, right? Be creative, be effective, be efficient, but it requires hard choices. So I would argue a bit that as you look at roles and missions and the demand signal from our civilian leadership, first of all, you got to incorporate the lessons learned from the last 12 years, 13 years of campaigning. We're different than we were in 1999. We're not returning to the past. Secondly, I'd argue that you have been part of a new American way of war. That's more joint, that's more combined, that's more interagency. And towards that end, the services have fulfilled their role as force providers and Title 10 providers, hugely important. But those TTPs, which you've developed, and the things that we have done in this last 10 to 13 years of campaigning have formed unique balances in terms of how we deal with conventional and special operations, how we do joint and combined things together, how we've incorporated the interagency into what we've done. This has been an evolutionary path, I'd argue. I'd also suggest that we've got the roles and missions, as you traditionally look at it, just about right. They're complementary, we're reasonably balanced, but if the funding, if those means continue to decline, there may be a harsh period where with sequestration and harsher sequestration kicking in, that folks will have to look at this a little differently, and there may be Key West periods where that water rushes up faster than you'd ever expect. So I acknowledge that, you know, Kaplan and Haas and others have painted a pretty dire set of circumstances about this changing world and the hybrid threats that we're going to face. I'd also argue that we operate in a very unique joint and combined environment, and that the President and the SecDef will place requirements and demands on combatant commanders. And those are going to be sourced by the services, and that supply-demand signal tension will continue to remain there. Because when the interagency gives the Department of Defense a task, you don't get to say, I don't want to do it. You just don't get to say that. And that comes at the cost of something else which is going on, especially if that requirement was not forecasted early along. That's the tension in phase zero operations, or what happens on a daily basis out in the world of the combatant commands as they operate out there doing training and exercises and building partner capacity with partners. So further down the table, we talked a little bit about the three QDR missions. I think those don't and shouldn't be repeated, but I would highlight again a little bit about the word balance that's in that document. Rebalance for the broad spectrum of conflict. Rebalance to sustain our presence abroad and better posture U.S. forces to protect national security interests. Rebalance capability, capacity, and readiness. Make the right future investments. And Chris talked a lot about those, as did Frank. Rebalance truth to tale, the business model. So I proceed by offering an overarching thought or two. And Dr. Thornhill talked a little bit about this yesterday. What does the United States want their role to be in the world? And fundamentally, we're struggling to figure that out right now. And then what should the U.S. military's role be in that, in support of that role? It's an ends, ways, means discussion that comes into play, not only for these longer-term periods, but also day-to-day. And then what do we and how do we want to use the instruments of power? It's the old dime permisi model, diplomacy, information, military, economic power. Those are arrows in a quiver. And most recently, every time we reach into the quiver, we find the bigger arrow, which has the big M on it, the military arrow. And I'm arguing that that M arrow is not going to be as prevalent in the past. It's going to be a smaller arrow. Sometimes it may have a little suction cup stuck on the end of it instead of a pointy arrow head. But you got to think about that, because these are the tools that our government tries to use. But think about the size of the budget. I mean, the U.S. military will get roughly $580 billion next year. And we're saying we can't do what? It's an interesting argument, isn't it? And it puts us in a pretty uncomfortable position when we try to pitch things back over the transom and tell our civilian leadership, can't do this. The question really is, you don't really want to do this. That's the problem, isn't it, military folks? So I think we're going to have to sort through dealing with ways, and I think we're going to have to go back and look at roles and missions, but in a different context. How do we bring, as Frank said, cyber back into the mix better? How do we bring the ISR, the CT special ops people back? We've come to a series of agreements of how that is done. How do we better institutionalize that? Space, precision strike, and things of that sort. That's the investment strategy that I think, and the roles and missions that have to be refined a whole lot more. And so, as I close, I offer a couple of other thoughts. If the means continue to decline, and the COCOMs and the services don't modify the ways, change the ways of doing business, those operational concepts, then roles and missions will have to get relooked in the more traditional way and will make some real difficult, terrible cuts in my mind that won't serve the nation well. We'll have to struggle with how to balance the phase zero task of what happens day to day and how you train and exercise with friends, Nate, and partners and build partner capacity. And in a resource-constrained environment, if we can't adapt the ways, then guess what? It will become more service-centric, and it won't be combined and joined, and won't reflect the ways we've done business in the last 10 to 15 years. And ultimately, I think the department has had a couple bites at the apple here at trying to shift attitudes and perspectives, not only over in the White House, but up on the Hill. So three bites of the apple since Secretary Gates said we'll take some cuts in fiscal year, in 2011, looking at fiscal year 12. Now we're up to about the fourth bite of the apple. And you're starting to see the Hill slowly come along and come around a bit. But recognize they control the means. They control the means. We ask for things, they give them to us. So in the end, as Billy Mabel said yesterday, you won't do more with less. I argue you'll do less with less. You'll have to figure out what's most important. And then you'll have to help our civilian leadership define what's most important in the absence of guidance, because the guidance won't be detailed or forthcoming in the way that you would expect. So I think this argument is a lot more about roles and missions, I'll tell you that much. And thanks a lot for allowing me to be here. It's always great coming back up here and being part of this august body. Back to you, Nate.
Thank you very much. That was terrific. Actually, I think it was a great rundown. We have about 30 minutes for questions, which is great. I think there's a lot of grist to be talked about on this subject, and I invite you to think about your question right now. Before we go right there, I want to ask one quick question, because General Miller touched the third rail of military policy in the United States, and I know that for the Army and the Marine Corps, the Army and the Air Force specifically, the Guard Reserve question is probably the most profound with respect to rebalancing and balancing within those two components. So let me ask if you think it's actually achievable to navigate through the difficult waters, the difficult political waters it takes to rebalance the Guard with the active component in the two services, the Army and the Air Force.
Thanks for that question, Nate. I do think it's possible. I think it's hard, but I think we've got the foundation to make that happen. A lot of people opposed the Chief of the National Guard Bureau becoming a member of the Joint Chiefs, but it has had some very constructive effects. And one of the things it's done is it has let the discussion rise to the level of the Chiefs. That maturity, which is still evolving, needs to happen across the states, it needs to happen in the Congress, it needs to be gradual.
Can't hear you in the back.
Is it not not transmitting?
No.
Okay.
You're
sorry
on
about
now.
That.
You're on now.
There we go. So the process needs to be gradual, and I should have made it clearer. What I'm talking about is essentially shifting those things that are truly dual use more toward the Guard, those things that are truly usable in the away game more toward the reserves. We already in the last few years decreased some of the boundaries for using active and reserve forces in disaster relief. Some of the relationships with FEMA and other places here in the U.S. have gotten much more specific and much more useful and much more rapid. And I saw that in my own house this summer, about three-quarters of a mile from a major wildfire in Colorado, when we actually had Air Force Reserve assets dropping fire retardant within less than 24 hours of the start of that fire. That would not have happened a few years before that. So there's a great deal of momentum in terms of people talking about these issues, and I think if it is looked at as a gradual process, because you have to remember that an active unit can be entirely different in two or three years as people come and go in the normal flow of assignments, and you can reassign missions, and we're used to that. For the guardsmen in particular, and for reservists to a lesser extent, that is where you live, that is your home, that is what you've done. You look at what the Air Force has done in moving, for example, the Maryland Guard from flying A-10s to cyber. that's not going to be a quick transition. So none of this will be quick, but I think with good faith and an effort to keep an eye on the goal, it is possible. It's just not going to be easy.
Great, thank you. Frank, I think you had an intervention on that.
Yeah, I'm a retired member of the Reserve Component, served on the Reserve Forces Policy Board, worked with the Reserve Component for a long time. I like to think of this as, for the future, it's a golden era for the Guard, in particular, in the Reserve Component. Contributions in the warfighting domain, contributions in Homeland Security, which is an important mission that they are, you know, on the front line of and close to, and they understand. In terms of new technologies and things like biotech and cyber and robotics, there's a future for them there, too. So they are a huge risk mitigator in some of the new means and somehow we rebalance risk. Might not be in the fight in the first day, but they actually have to be ready. We just can't have our father's guard or the reserves that I, you know, graduated from or retired from. So in my wild paper that I wrote last year, I increased guard pay pretty substantially. In terms of number of drills. If you wanted them to be more ready, we're going to have to invest in that. We need some hybrid organizations that are designed for that training readiness mission and for the new technologies that they can bring to bear from their industrial and private sector experience. So I think the future for the Guard is really strong. It's probably not been properly talked to, I think, in those terms. But even on the prevention side with Partnership for Peace and things, it's another low-cost, high-impact way that we should be advancing as much as possible. But it can't be our father's guard, so there's training simulation, there's new infrastructure, and there's things that have to be invested in that, but I think the payoff's great.
Okay, I'm going to open it up to the floor now. I think you had a question back here. Yes, sir.
So, Chaplain Brandt, Seminar 4, Delaware National Guard. The Noah story, just so you know how that ends. He plants a vineyard, he gets drunk, and then the Lord says you can eat every animal that you saved on the ark. So just be careful about that analogy.
Yeah.
I thought you were going to be more concerned about the sinfulness and the sloth of the population that got wiped out by the flood in the first place. But go ahead.
It's a paycheck every week for me. Anyways,
told him he shouldn't use it. Yeah.
In regards to the National Guard Reserve, is there, especially with the Guard, are you was there an advocacy more for a Title 32 role and a lesser Title 10 role?
Is that addressed to me, sir?
Ground air or in general?
I think that's a general question. So, but General Miller, why don't you take off on
okay.
that?
Because
I think
you not necessarily a lesser Title 10 role, but a greater alignment of assets. Here's an example. The Air Guard has always been concerned about being current with equipment. So right now the plan is for the Air Guard to get F-35s in a relatively even lay down with the active. That works. That's what we've done over the last few years. But I think there's also an argument to be made that if you're going to have the Air Guard fly fighter aircraft, they should be fighter aircraft that are new enough to play in the Title 10 world, absolutely, but they should be appropriate to the mission that the state may have. So if there's a need for an air defense mission, air sovereignty mission, that can be done by a new fourth generation fighter, if we end up buying any more of those in the future, that would be a better fit than something that we know we're going to have to use on day one of a conflict. Same thing, the folks in the deep interior of the country, makes sense for them to have airlift aircraft, may not make as much sense for them to have fighter aircraft. So it's not a diminution of the Title 10 role, it's moving slowly toward a better fit for the things that Title 32 may actually require them to do.
So just a thought for you. I mean, an enormous amount of what Northern Command has to deal with complex catastrophes in support of DHS and others. So the reality of it is, if there's a complex catastrophe from another Katrina to earthquakes to, you know, hornets, locusts, you name it, the problem becomes that you will rely on the total force to be able to do that. And so the question is, have you geared the force appropriately to be able to respond with the right capabilities and the right training to be able to do so? You won't get a pass. So the question is, how do you have a force that's balanced enough to be able to do that? And again, when you look at the number of men and women and the size of our military and that which resides in the United States, it's quite large. So the question is, have you tailored it right, appropriately, and trained it to be able to deal with not just the defense of the homeland, but the complex catastrophes that you might experience that far exceed the capabilities of, you know, local and state officials to be able to do it. So there's a lot to do for everyone. I would argue that there's plenty for everyone here. So you can argue over, well, I should be flying helicopters or not helicopters or this type of helicopter or that. I would argue there's more than enough work for everyone when you start laying out all the possibilities.
Great. We have a question, actually. I want to acknowledge again our audience, our virtual audience. We have a question from Afghanistan, and I'm going to Robert, hello out there in Afghanistan. I'm going to actually cut it down to what I think is the heart of the question. It's for General Wolff. General Wolff, you said we're still going to be required to do sort of a myriad set of missions that's very broad, and that we'll have to accept the fact that we'll have to respond to those missions. Is there some way that we can actually accept more risk in some of those missions and acknowledge that risk up front so that we can basically communicate to the senior leadership of the department and to the president that we can do everything, but we will do some things with greater risk?
Yeah, it's really a great question, and I assume the author, is, since he's in Afghanistan, perhaps is, you know, making reference to, you know, what our enduring presence will be, obviously. And so the answer is, yeah, sure. I mean, what the military's responsibility is to give our civilian leaders a range of options so that the secretary, the combat commanders put this together through the joint staff to the department so that the secretary has a range of options, not just one option. And then when that goes over to the White House through the interagency process, there are a range of options, more than one. There is no preferred COA. There are a range of options so that our senior civilian leadership can have a discussion about this. And when the end states that are articulated or the task or the requirements that are given, you know, there's a dynamic between those end states, the means and the ways that goes on with every single problem set that is discussed over there. And over there being over on the National Security Council, whether it's an Africa situation or whether it's an enduring presence in Afghanistan. And so you hit a point in that analysis when the ends or the requirements exceed the forces that people want to allow you to have to solve the problem. Guess what? You rewrite the mission statement. You adapt the mission statement because when you do your analysis of risk to force and risk to mission, you recognize that it's too high and you can't accomplish the mission the way you hope to. So if you can't get more force there, or you can't bring other ways to bear, and through a whole of government effort, then ultimately you have to rethink what the mission is that you can accomplish. That's a healthy discussion that happens between the military and our civilian leadership. It's not a degradation of civil-military relations. It's the natural discussion that has to occur. There's supposed to be a debate about these things. So I think that's what the questioner is asking me about. And that discussion happened in great detail over about an 18-month process with the enduring presence numbers in Afghanistan. Yeah.
Great. Next question. Yes, sir.
Chick Feldmayer, retired colonel from the Army, and I'm currently a lobbyist in Washington for NAMO. Jerry, I'd like to ask you a question. I'd like to start with what I got out of Richard Haass's, was the emphasis on a balanced force. And you inferred in your discussion that through proper resourcing, you could go to closer to a 300-ship Navy. In that assumption, were you basing it on some of Admiral Ridgway's study that came out about a year ago that brought the Army down to 320? And I'd just like to know what you think of that study, and do you believe that that's where the Army needs to be?
I'm not familiar with that particular study, or for that matter, that
Admiral Roughhead.
Admiral Roughhead, I'm sorry.
Of the Navy.
Yeah, okay. Former CNO. It was a Brookings study.
Yeah. So, no, I did not base my numbers off from Admiral Roughhead's study, although I'm familiar with Admiral Roughhead's study. I differentiate from him based upon the internal character, characteristics of the ships that I would put into the Navy, what investments I'd make with that 10%, $1.2 billion of the shipbuilding budget. And I would invest in those types of ships, which I call influence operations type vessels. Right now, the current shipbuilding plan invests heavily in high-end exquisite technologies like Arleigh Burke-class destroyers, continuation of those, as well as current aircraft carriers and the fast attack force. I think a portion of our budget can be invested in some of these lower-end ships, dramatically growing our numbers. If you take $1.2 billion, you spread it over those types of platforms, you can add anywhere from 6 to 10 additional ships per year within the shipbuilding plan, and that takes you from 280 right now to not just 300, but in fact 330 within a 7 to 8 year period of time. And I think that that's critical given the areas that we need to be in order to uphold the current global governance. You cannot retract yourself out of a region and then think that you're going to be able to get back in there and have the same level of influence. Once you recede, someone else has the opportunity to step in and establish new rule sets and new rules of the road with regard to interpretations of UNCLOS or free navigation. So you have to remain forward presence in order to maintain your current traditions, or for that matter, the current interpretations of the law. So my analysis actually came out of work that I began when I was in OSD policy at the end of the Bush administration and during the transition in the beginning of the Obama administration. I worked in the Office of Force Development and began to build up my analytical model there using raw numbers that I got from CAPE on cost per platforms, and then we came up with this alternative, and then I published a series of articles on this nature of the influence squadron. And so that's really what I'm talking about.
Yes, sir. Thank you. Ben Caulfield. I'm a Foreign Service Officer with the U.S. Agency for International Development. Over the last few days, we've heard a lot about current and upcoming global challenges from Kaplan and Haas. Kaplan commented that our foreign policy apparatus is too horizontal and not integrated enough to address the challenges. I think many of the challenges that we heard about, I would agree with some of the comments from General Wolff that these are not just military missions and roles. We need to exercise all the elements of our power. My question is, has the time come for a Goldwaters-Nichols 2 to integrate the interagency? What are the possibilities of achieving that in this political environment? And if not, what are some alternatives? Thank you.
Thank you very much for the question. I'm going to actually kick that over to our partner, Sam Brannen, from CSIS first, and then allow everyone else to comment.
I think the short answer is it's absolutely past time for that kind of an action, but there is not will to do it. It's not even something that's kind of in the Washington vocabulary right now. There are great studies that have been done on just this issue, Project on National Security Reform, Beyond Goldwater-Nichols, a lot of great work out there on this that kind of could be put into effect, but there isn't will for any number of reasons, but we're not going to get any better at it. And I think the approaches that we've seen and the challenges that have been encountered over the past decade should have been instructive that it really was time for this change. I think this is the kind of issue that, given where past national security reforms have come from, and that I alluded to that earlier, it has to come really from the level of the president. There has to be a personal commitment there that this is something that he, she wants to do. And in that context, I think you have to think about it as a kind of 2016 issue, and a good one that all of us who care about future national security should start advocating for now to get that dialogue going.
Frank and General Wolff, in order.
Oh, just a quick comment. You know, Goldwaters-Nichols was really about attitudes, some cultural aspects of the military, and the need to work together. The deficiencies on the diplomatic and the developmental side is an understanding in the larger policy elites about the role of these tools and their capacity. It's not about as much, I think, the integration of these in the field or strategically. So a Goldwaters-Nichols thing doesn't get at the capacity problem. We need strong institutions in those areas, even in a world in which power is diffused and a globalized economy where we don't manipulate economic things at the strategic or operational level really well. You know, we still need those strong institutions, and they can be bigger, but that's a money problem from Congress. It's not an attitude or a cultural and educational deficiency, in my view.
So, I mean, you asked if, you know, AID is a critical component to those arrows in the quiver I described, and the answer is absolutely yes. So you look at the size of the budget numbers I threw out for the Department of Defense, you look at the size of the Department of State's budget, right, maybe somewhere between 30 and 40 billion. They're almost a rounding error against DOD's budget. What's AID's portion of that? Very, very small. And so the issue is, again, and Richard Haass talked a little bit about this, if we want to have more a bigger D, and if we want to have, as part of that D, diplomacy, if we want to have assistance as part of that, then we've got to get the numbers commensurate with the influence we think we want to bring forth. It's about figuring out what you want to be again, right? So you can't, you know, and I'm giving you a quotation from an old friend of mine who said, listen, we have a champagne appetite, we the United States, on a beer budget. Nothing, that's absolutely right. We want to do everything, but we're drinking generic beer. And that's what we're resourcing some of this stuff with.
Duels.
Yeah. And natural so so I think your answer is absolutely right. It's true. We have to be able to do more. But, you know, when you think about the amount of money that we're dealing with, the U.S. government is putting forth just to deal with the Syria refugee problem, it's over $1 billion. That is consuming USAID's budget for this particular year. Back to the NSC question. There are probably 10 students in here that are writing a paper about how to reorganize the National Security Council and the interagency process. And most of you have never been in an interagency meeting. So, and I don't pick fault with you for that, but I've been in hundreds of them and ran many of them. The National Security Council is the president's staff. The Bush National Security Council is a little different than the Obama National Security Council. Why? It's the president's staff. So all you commanders out there, put your commander hat on, and your staff, when you were downrange commanding things, or when you go out and command, your staff reflects your personality and your decision-making style to some degree. The same is true in the White House. It's about information requirements. It's about how concepts and courses of action or options are brought forward to the president. It's about how the president processes some information. So you want that legislated if you're the president of the United States? Really? So the challenge is, and all of that comes at a cost of the secretaries of the departments. So for the more operationalized you make the National Security Council, it comes at the cost of the Secretary of Defense's authority. Or the Secretary of State's authority, okay? Or the Attorney General's, or Treasury's, or you name it, or USAID, because they're at the table. So the challenge I would argue is that there may be times when things would be more efficient and could be more streamlined, but no problem that walks into the NSC is an easy problem. Otherwise, the departments would have solved them all by themselves. So the reform should do no harm, it should make things better, and you've got to convince Congress, and the way we get those means, if you will, because Congress gives us the dollars and the things that have become the programs, that has to be also brought into some sort of alignment. And that's very, very difficult right now.
So unless you want to create within the State Department or within the interagency something that's equivalent to the COCOMs, which, you know, for all intent and purposes, have these large regional responsibilities, you're not going to see that strengthening. And the one example that I think that gives us a path forward or something to look at is Stavridis' time at Southcom, where he institutionalized or instituted putting interagency partners at the table as J-codes, literally, you know, taking what had been formerly a military role, but that they had responsibilities on his senior staff. So there is opportunities within the COCOMs to bring the interagency forward and give them greater voice in those conversations, unless you actually want to radically restructure the COCOMs and look at a State Department role within those.
Yeah, I want to add something on this, because I think what struck me recently, or at least over the last couple of years, is there were no greater advocates, frankly, for the whole of government approach and all of the things that go with that and had rhetorically gone with that anyway, post 9/11, going into the 2008 election. There were no greater advocates than actually the team that came in 2008. And to show you how difficult the climate is when actually
aspiration met reality in the decision-making of government, which I think is exactly what General Wolff is referring to. Now you're at a point, I would argue, just because of the resource tensions, the history of the last 14 years, et cetera, that not only is whole of government sort of the concept going to be very difficult to achieve, but in fact jointness itself is at some risk because of the tension internally inside the Department of Defense over resources, right? So I think you're actually climbing up two hills there to a certain extent.
Nate, can I add to that?
Yeah.
So I disagree with Nate. My point is you've done interagency operations at the tactical level. You did them in Iraq, you did them in Afghanistan. You've done them at the operational level. If you were at Central Command or at USFI or MNFI, you did those. And you got pretty good at them. And in phase zero, everywhere else out of the CENTCOM area of responsibility where we do not have warlike authorities, we have a very different challenge in terms of getting resources. But that doesn't mean we don't integrate between state. So when a combatant commander travels, if General Rodriguez goes out there and travels, quite often he has the Assistant Secretary of State for Africa Affairs travel with him. And they land at country X, and guess who meets them? The ambassador, who is the president's representative on the ground, plus the defense attaché, and on they go. But that's not a wartime climate, right? That is considered phase zero kind of peacetime operations. So what I would argue is that we have done interagency really well at the tactical level. We've learned a lot. We've incorporated that. We've done it at the operational level. At the strategic level, sometimes it's a little harder. It's because of the nature and the complexity of the problems. And trying to make large departments try to do what needs to be done in a timely fashion, which meets an NSC and senior civilian leadership demand signal. So I don't think the system needs to be destroyed. I think the system continues to need to be modified. It's evolutionary. And where I disagree with Nate is I'm not so sure that we're at risk of this all going over the transom yet because of budget challenges. I think you all have taken all these lessons learned and you'll take these forward in your future assignments. And we're pretty solid with that. And so will a lot of your State Department counterparts that were out there in PRTs that are young and upcomers now. Just a thought.
Yeah, I think that's fair, actually. I think one of the things I'd say is just that what's at risk really is the aspirational formalization that people seek to create a national, you know, defense university for the interagency, to all the things that you heard of that were kind of the early lessons of the war years. I think we're going to still actually have that practical experience that we're going to bring forward, and we're going to a certain extent muddle through, which is not actually a bad thing. It's taking that experience forward and expanding on it. So I better, instead of hogging the microphone, I better actually point out another. Where? Did I one way back there? Yep, all the way in the back. Robert Bunker.
Thank you. This is a question, or actually an idea, I want to bounce off Captain Hendrix. I think we should get deadly serious about future warfare and also maybe educate our politicians. So what I'm thinking maybe we should do is attempt to replicate the 1920s sinking of the German battleship with carriers and air power. But in this case, I'm proposing that we attempt to sink an old U.S. carrier with a massive swarm of small and smart UAVs as kind of a proof of concept of maybe where future warfare is going and the different types of platforms we might need in the future.
Jerry, I would suggest that the USS George Washington, which is going to be laid up, is a fine available target set. It will kill two problems. It will save $7 billion for the CNO.
Stop, Frank.
And amply prove
stop. This is on Facebook that Frank would be a troll, someone who's just there to stir the pot. So it's an excellent question. It's an excellent scenario. Unfortunately, in my day job, I can tell you the reason why you can't, the environmental issues. Dealing with decontaminating an aircraft carrier to make it ready to become an artificial reef are almost insurmountable. So much so that we took the USS Forrestal, the first supercarrier, and sold it to a breaker for a penny because we couldn't find anybody who would take it because of the environmental risk associated with their firm. Recently, there was a firm who took an older ship, and they broke the firm to break it up dealing with all the environmental. But your issue dealing with the idea of doing some sort of a test, perhaps in a simulated environment where the entire scenario has been programmed in so that you get the survivability, might be an interesting war game that could be done within, again, a computerized simulated environment. But certainly not something with something that large just because of all the regulatory oversight that goes with the disposition of ships these days.
General Van Riper did that in Millennium Challenge
2000. I'd like to respond. I think for the future of national defense in our nation, I think we could take the hit on the environment with one carrier.
You are enlightened beyond most regulatory agencies.
General Miller.
Yeah, I just want to toss out a word of caution. One of my colleagues up here mentioned moving more into unmanned vehicles. I think we have to be really careful not to take negative learning from the last decade. And if we are concerned about an important national security mission, an important military mission, and we want to do it at a cost that we can bear, unmanned vehicles in their current state are not necessarily what we want to do. Avoiding risk to one, two, or four humans is not really an important consideration. I know I strapped into airplanes for a lot of years, and I did it for the same reason that all of you in uniform do what you do. If you need to go do a mission, that's what you do. So if the platforms that we're talking about can't do the job more effectively, more reliably, or cheaper, we need to take a deep breath and not think that because MQ-9s fly over undefended territory very successfully that we can scale that and put it into high threat areas and expect to get the same results.
General Wolff.
I would just say your thought about educating the Congress and the American people is hugely important, and I think that's been some of the struggle that you've seen the service secretaries and the chairman, the service chiefs deal with up on the Hill recently, and that's why I described it bites of the apple. Right, it's not resonating. And we talk in parables, and we talk in tongues sometimes, and it doesn't make sense up on the Hill when we get the limited amount of time we get with our congressional leaders and the members of the key committees. So we really struggle articulating a compelling case why this nation should spend more money on defense in light of what we want to be in this globalized era. And we struggle with that. We struggle with the narrative.
Great. Well, it's actually time for me to transition to my role of keeping us on time. And so I'm going to actually ask you to thank the panel for their discussion on roles and missions today. And actually, if you don't mind, I'm going to stay here to talk about the next event. I actually joked outside that I walked off the stage after Dr. Haas without telling you what to do, having forgotten that I'm actually with a military audience, and many would have probably stayed for another hour or two in their place if I didn't say anything. So I've been a soldier before, I know as well. So what I want to just emphasize is we have a very interesting and important panel with a lot of members on it at lunchtime. And it's going to really require, if you're going to lunch, it's really going to require you to kind of get over, get through the chow line, and actually get in your seat and have eaten substantial amounts of your meal by the time the panel gets underway. So if I could ask those that are involved in that to make their way over now, and everybody else, we will reconvene at 1:15 back here. Thank you.